So welcome to our last talk of this Physics at the Edge of Philosophy series. And as you can see, the title is about first principles. So we'll be doing the format where I do the first half, and then Julie will do the second half on philosophy. And I think the last lecture, lecture 4, worked out really well with each of us not knowing what the other is going to say ahead of time. So we did the same deal here. So I don't know what she's going to talk about. She doesn't know what I'm talking about. So there's going to be some confrontation. At the end. So with the tension mounting, let's start. The outline of my half of the talk.
The confrontation began already with the previous.
Yes, that is true. If you notice, there is a quite obscene quote against physics. She made me right. Anyways, so let's start. So, physics, as we know it today, started around the 16th century. And it evolved from the 16th century to classical physics, then quantum physics in the 20th century. And over this period, it got rather complex. Many sub-disciplines of physics opened up. The field itself is a vast one. Now people often specialize in different areas within physics. But it is important to remember our understanding of physics today is really based on only a few big ideas. It's as if nature has a small group of tricks in its bag, which it uses over and over again in very different physical systems. Now, I see people arriving in the back, so should I put the microphone on? Can you hear me in the back? Okay, put the microphone on. Okay, let's see. I will put the microphone on as long as I can figure out how to turn on this stupid device. Here we go. You have to open a compartment for the battery to see the on-off switch. It's quite... Can you hear me? Okay, it's working.
Better.
Okay, so now I'll shove it down my throat, and you'll hear me better. Is this better?
Yes.
Okay. So physics is really founded on a very small set of principles, which over time, over the past centuries, have actually evolved and have been rephrased over and over again in deeper and deeper ways, perhaps. And it is these few principles that appear across many areas within physics. Physical systems that are very different from each other seem to use the same tricks, the same sort of principles at their core. And those principles are very beautiful. They're very frugal. So what I want to do is give you my viewpoint about what modern physics is really based on. What are the key principles, which everything we know is sort of made of. And that is the physics perspective of today's laws of physics. So I'm going to focus on three such principles, the most important three, if not all three. And I'll call one perception, the other symmetry, and the third time. And I'll explain each one in turn before handing off the talk to Julie. So let's start about perception. From the instant we are born, we have a certain perception of the world around us in three different ways. We have a perception, can you see the slide?
Yes.
Should I turn off
what
lights?
What is that in the upper arrow?
Good. So this is length, mass, and going vertically up is time.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So we have a perception of three different things, length, time, and mass. So length, we immediately have a notion of how long something is, how high it is, and we develop this notion as we grow up. And we have a three-dimensional world, so we measure length in three different directions independently. We have a notion of mass. By that we mean that we have a perception of things being made of stuff. So So this bottle has stuff in it, I can touch it. So we can quantify that with mass. The third perception is actually the weirdest one, time. From the moment we live, we seem to be trusted in the direction of evolving time as we live our miserable lives, and we have no control over it. So that's a different perception of something, time. Length, time, and mass. Every physical process that we observe around us has at least three numbers associated with it, which tell you roughly what this physical process is doing. A measure of length, a measure of mass, and a measure of time. For example, if I were to take a piece of chalk and drop it to the ground, then this physical process has a characteristic mass, the mass of the chalk, a characteristic length, the length the chalk fell, and the characteristic time, the time it took to hit the ground. Every physical process you can think of, however simple or complex, has at least three of these numbers. So these are the characteristic length, time, and mass of the system. So if I were to plot a three-dimensional view physical process where you have axis length, mass, and vertical axis time, then any physical process is a point in this three-dimensional space. The chalk falling to the ground is a particular corner of the space associated with the mass being, you know, a few grams, a few meters, a few seconds for the time. So this is the parameter space of any physical process based on our perceptions that we are born with. This parameter space actually has no a priori special regions or scales, meaning that every point in this parameter space, every length, time, and mass, is a priori equivalent to any other one. A meter is the same as 10 meters, a second is the same as a century. So, psychologically speaking, or maybe philosophically speaking, there is no need to make any special attribute, to give any special attribute to any region of this parameter space. But that's exactly what physics does. Physics is about identifying regions of this parameter space as being special. The first comes about from the speed of light. A principle in physics coming from relativity says nothing can go faster than the speed of light. So that means that there's a corresponding length and time region in this space which is forbidden. Because if you were in that region, it means you would go faster than the speed of light. So if I were to shade that region, it would look something like this. It would look like this wedge, this blue wedge. Anywhere inside this wedge corresponds to points where a physical process with the corresponding length, mass, and time is describing an object moving too fast, which is impossible. So now the parameter space of the world around us is confined to the space above the plane. So a physical statement eliminated a region of the parameter space. The second hallmark of physics comes from Planck's constant, quantum physics. Quantum physics tells you that there's an inherent uncertainty in nature, that, for example, like we learned in lecture 2, if you were around, that you cannot measure the position and speed of something with arbitrary accuracy. So this restricts length, time, mass parameters of any physical process because there's quantum fuzziness. There's regions where you cannot explore because of quantum mechanics. This region, well, this is, by the way, a view of the speed of light region, and here's the quantum region. Oh my God, you cannot see anything, can you? Let me see if I can turn off lights and then... Is this helping or making you sleep? This should be really good. It's raining outside, it's dark inside. I'll wake you up at the end of the talk. Let me see. Is this better? No?
Just point. Just
turn them all on.
There. Okay. So I'm not sure if you can see well, but there is a red region, red surface standing, a whole region on the top, where maybe if I click it and it rotates, you'll see it better. You see, here you go. So all that region corresponds to physical processes which are forbidden by quantum mechanics. So now physical processes must lie in the wedge between the two surfaces, which is now empty. So again, physics came in and added an ingredient which zeroed in or made a certain region of this parameter space special via quantum mechanics. There's one more constant or fundamental constant in nature which plays a similar role. Can you guess? Newton's constant of gravity. That's another quantity that we have to measure, a number. Newton's constant of gravity tells you if a physical process, in it, gravity is important or it's too weak to matter. So, in this parameter space, it appears as this green surface, which by now you cannot see anything of, but I'll animate it, maybe that will help. Let me animate it first. And you see there's this green surface cutting across here. Now it's a bit clearer, I hope. I think it's more viewable. So you see, before the green area, this green surface, we have a whole region, this wedge region, which is available for us for physical processes. And then Newton's constant of gravity comes in as a surface in this parameter space and tells you that if you're away from this surface on this side, the physical process has weak gravity in it. Maybe you can even ignore gravity and get by. As you approach the surface, the physical process involves gravity. So, for example, the chalk falling on the ground may be a point hanging somewhere here, close to the surface, but not very close. If you go to the right of this, then this region corresponds to length, times, and masses where a black hole has formed. And you're studying a physical process within the horizon of the black hole. Now, classical gravity, general relativity, will tell you that's fine and you can do physics here. But we learned, for example, in lecture four, 2 weeks ago, that string theory may be suggesting to us that actually this region may also be inaccessible or fuzzed out in some way. So, this is the story about the three length scales and the three fundamental constants of nature in modern physics. We have this region of parameter space. Different physicists hang around in different regions. So I can put some labels here. So here's this, in this corner, in this dark corner, are particle physicists like me. And there's condensed matter physics here. Astrophysics is sort of everywhere where gravity is important. But I also do string theory, right? So you say, where the heck is string theory? And for that, you'll have to see a cool animation. So you zero in at the intersection of the three surfaces. This is a region where a physical process involves quantum mechanics. At the same time, it involves speed close to that of light. And it involves gravity as an important force. So when all three hallmarks of physics become important simultaneously, that's the region where string theory is supposed to address. Currently, without string theory, we do not have a framework to describe that region. Otherwise, the parameter space I showed you is actually pretty well captured with the equations of physics that we have in modern physics today. Any questions on these generalities? So, let me look at it in a slightly different way, and now I will turn on lights because people are squinting. So, I drew a triangle because triangles have three corners and I have three fundamental constants in nature. So, I'll call one corner Newton's constant, and look, I'll put even the value for it. So, this is a measured value. Then there's the speed of light, which has that number to it. And then there's Planck's constant for quantum mechanics, which has that number to it. Okay. So each of these three constants corresponds to a certain framework within physics that makes a region of the length-time mass parameter space special, inaccessible, if you will. So here they are, and let me put some faces on them. Newton's constant is due to Newton. Speed of light brought into physics as a special scale is due to Einstein. And Planck's constant was introduced into physics by Schrödinger and Heisenberg. So these are sort of the three important frameworks in physics. And today we have two theoretical constructs which we use to describe everything in physics. Whenever gravity and the speed of light, Newton's constant and speed of light, are important together, collectively there's a framework which is called general relativity due to Einstein, which describes gravity very well. On the other side, if you remember from lecture 4, we talked about the two phases in string theory or physics in general, gravity and the matter that gravitates. So everything else is stuff like us which gravitates. And the matter is described within a framework where quantum mechanics and the speed of light can become important at the same time through something called quantum field theories. So today physics is two constructs. General relativity, which describes the gravity side, and matter, described by a set of theories called quantum field theories, which are in the same happy family. Okay? Now, do you see some missing arrows? So what if you want to do gravity and quantum mechanics at the same time? Well, that's the realm of so-called quantum gravity, in principle, untested, non-existent theory of nature, but basically a hole in our understanding of physics today. Now you say, okay, if these three constants are around, why not, as we said, study a physical process where all three constants are important? That's the center of the triangle, and that is the realm of string theory. So, the question marks are supposed to suggest to you that we really don't know these areas. They're not experimentally tested. They're basically work in progress. So today, physics as an experimental science is based on two pillars, general relativity and quantum field theory. So, the first principle I want to state, the first principle of today's modern physics is based on the fact that there are three natural scales in nature: speed of light, Planck's constant, Newton's constant. And everything is described with two pillars, theoretical frameworks, general relativity and quantum field theory. And our understanding of modern physics, even though through these tools, is very robust, it also has some major holes in it. You see, that triangle I showed you earlier had some holes in it, and it's still incomplete, and work is in progress to complete it. Yeah. So that's principle one. The second principle I call Noether's theorem. This is a theorem that was developed in the beginning of the 20th century by a mathematician by the name of Emmy Noether. Emmy Noether was one of the first female mathematicians, and her theorem, which I'm going to state now, really changed the way we think about physics. Yet she's not very much recognized. In fact, her entire career she had trouble finding an academic position because she was a woman. Eventually, they found her a job at Brandeis. But she did this theorem, stated it, and proved it at home. So she didn't have a job when she did it. So Noether's theorem is absolutely beautiful. It's physics at its best, because the best physics is simple and frugal, yet says a lot. So Noether's theorem can be stated very simply. It says if you have a symmetry in nature, then that implies there's a conserved quantity. There's a quantity that remains constant in time. So let me explain this. This is rigorously proven theorem. It's not just a statement. So imagine I have an experiment, and I do the experiment today here in front of you, a tabletop experiment, and I get some results. Now, I put my experimental setup aside, and then a week from now I'll come and repeat the exact same experiment, and I reproduce the same results. Nothing changes. And I can do it a week later, 10 days later, a month later, and the results don't change. Then I say that the physical system I'm studying is invariant, does not change under translation in time. It's a fancy way of saying that it doesn't change as a function of time. So if there's a symmetry in nature having to do with the laws of physics not changing as a function in time, we say there's a time translational symmetry. I can do, by the way, that's a picture of Noether. And I can do a translation in time, and the physical outcome doesn't change. I can do the experiment in a week, and the results would be the same. Then, Noether says that in this experiment, a certain combination of length, time, and mass remains a constant in time. And that constant, Noether's theorem tells you what it exactly is. And if you compute it, that's exactly what we call energy. So energy, its reason for living, is time translational symmetry. That's the only reason we call anything energy. So it's extremely profound. How about if I have an experiment I do here in front of you, and then I stop, finish it, get the results, and then move the whole setup over there, or maybe a few meters to the side, and repeat the experiment and reproduce the same result. That means the physical processes involved are invariant under translation in space. I could translate the system in space, and the physics didn't change. So that's a symmetry, which we call space translational symmetry. Noether's theorem says there's something, the combination of length, time, and mass, that remains constant in time. So it tells you exactly what that combination is, and that's what we call momentum. So you say, okay, what's momentum, by the way? Mass times velocity. So that combination is special. So then you say, okay, what if momentum is not constant? We have a situation where space translation symmetry is broken. Then the rate of change of momentum is what we call force. So you see, all these catchphrases in physics, the vocabulary of physics, is based on things having to do with symmetry. Noether's theorem tells you that physics is the art of cataloging the symmetries of nature. It's a very profound reformulation of physics. So Noether's theorem is an organizational framework. It tells you, as a physicist, your task is to catalog the symmetries of nature. Go to your experimental setup. Take some data about a process you don't understand. Look at the numbers that you registered and try to see a pattern in these numbers, a symmetry. And once you identify that pattern, that's what physics is. The pattern, the laws, the rules to reproduce this pattern is what physics is. Now, there's one more, there's a whole bunch of symmetries and conserved quantities that you can think of, but one category is particularly interesting, and that is some abstract twists. You can even imagine them as translational symmetries in higher dimensions. Like we have three space dimensions, but imagine we have a fourth space dimension, and we have a symmetry of translation in these fourth dimensions. Or you can imagine even more crazier abstract twists of some sort of mathematical nature, which we cannot visualize or draw a picture of, you know, in the real physical space we live in. So there's a whole bunch of symmetries that you can come up with in sort of on paper. And each of the symmetries will have conserved quantities. So a class of these symmetries are associated with charges, electric charge, nuclear charge, all these charges that generate force, electric charge generates electric force. All these charges emanate because of the existence of certain abstract symmetries in nature. So everything is about symmetry, even the catalog of forces. So I'll tell you another thing associated with this, which is very beautiful. Now, symmetries can have interesting mathematical structure to them. For example, imagine the symmetry of a sphere. Now, if you take the sphere, just take the equator, the circle, and then you can spin the circle, and it won't change the sphere. So that's some sort of rotation symmetry, right? But you can also take the whole sphere and spin it in two different directions and still not change the sphere. So you can think of the spin of the equator of the sphere as being a subset of a larger symmetry of the spinning of the whole sphere in two directions. So symmetries can be organized in a hierarchy. You have more or less symmetry. Some symmetries are subset of other symmetries. And symmetries are being associated with, for example, charges or forces. So this gives us a program in physics, which has been going on for a century, of unification of forces through symmetries. For example, at the turn of the 20th century, or the end of the 19th century, we knew of the electric and magnetic force. But then a symmetry was discovered, which has something to do with the speed of light. And that also tells you that the electric and magnetic forces are the two faces of the same force, called the electromagnetic force. We also discovered concurrently to this a force called the weak force. The weak force is about radioactivity. And soon after that, in the 70s, I guess, a bunch of theorists recognized that the symmetries associated with the weak and electromagnetic forces are actually part of a bigger symmetry. And this led to the unification of the two forces. So now we talk of electroweak force. So very cool. You see, there's a sort of a unity. The symmetry organizes things in a structure, which is very beautiful. Now, there's also something called the nuclear force, which is called strong force technically in physics. So people have been hitting their heads on the walls for now 50 years trying to unify the electroweak and strong force by looking at their symmetries. We don't have the answer to this. We can write some equations called GUT theories, grand unified theories. And these theories are not tested experimentally, but it's possible. Do you see a force that's missing in this diagram? What's the first force that we know?
Gravity.
So then there's a program of combining the symmetries responsible for the gravitational force with the symmetries responsible for all the other forces. That program, under another name, is called string theory. So all fit together in this organizational framework, which is driven by symmetry and the catalog of symmetries. So that's the second principle I want to mention, that symmetry is really at the core of all the laws of physics. That brings me to the last short principle, and this is an incomplete principle. I call it something to do with time. I don't know what to call it otherwise. It's very basic. In classical physics, we take it for granted, but it is basically a foundational aspect of physics, that everything is arranged as follows. You give me initial conditions, and then physics will tell me some equations, and the equations will predict the future. So I'll give you an example. Look, so that I don't get accused of being too theoretical, I'll do a demo with a chalk. So if I have a chalk, and I want to throw it in that trash can. Then, if I specify the initial position of the chalk and the speed at which the velocity I'm throwing it with, then the physics equation will tell me the trajectory for all future times. So, initial conditions, equations of physics, and let's see if I can hit it. No, I did not. And on top of it, it's on camera. So this is the classical picture of physics. Now, if you came to quantum lecture, you learned that things got a little bit screwy in the quantum world, which is the real world, of course. And in the real world, which is the quantum where things are fuzzy, you cannot determine things with certainty, and determinism is out the window. So you can specify initial conditions in codes, because it's difficult to know everything about initial conditions in a fuzzy world. But quantum mechanics still provides you with a set of equations, and instead of telling you the future, it will tell you the likely future, so which is good enough. It will tell you statistics instead of telling you a deterministic outcome. So this is the third principle of physics, that you specify initial conditions and physics will tell you the future. Now, the important point I want to make here, though, is that this principle is really incomplete. It's, the reason it's incomplete because physics does not have inherently in it a distinction between past and future. The arrow of time going from initial conditions to the future can be reversed, and physics equations are totally fine with it. So something is screwy about this, having to do with our perception of time as something that we are driven into without control, time evolving constantly forward in, you know, in time, no pun intended. So in the second lecture of this series, we talked about a suggestion that time has to do with disorder and disorder increasing in the universe. But this is sort of a hypothesis, and there's still a lot to reformulate to make this principle a little bit clearer. So these are my three principles of physics. That first, there are three fundamental constants or scales in nature: speed of light, Newton's gravity constant, and quantum mechanics Planck's constant. Each one of these give you an important natural scale in physics and the corresponding framework. At the end of the day, the parameter space of length, time, and mass available for us is described with two frameworks in physics. Quantum field theories describe matter, general relativity describes gravity. Second, symmetry is extremely important in physics. It's an organizational principle. Physics is about cataloging the symmetries of nature. And the third, that there is a certain axiomatic statement in physics that what physics is about is tell me the beginning, I'll tell you the future, yet it makes no distinction between past and present. So that's the first principle of modern physics that everywhere in the laws of physics appear. And at this point, I will hand off to Julie, who is going to give us a perspective on first principles from philosophy. And I do not know exactly what she's going to say. Sure. Yes, let me give you my microphone.
All right. So now the easy stuff. And actually, last time, if you were here, there was an excellent question that was asked at the very end by one of the audience members, one of you. The question was, are we talking about the same thing in physics and in philosophy when we talk about first principles? So this is the question. And basically, I'm going to ask you to think about the answer to this question. So what I will do is I will talk about the first principles of philosophy. And now, just a moment ago, we heard about the first principles of physics, and you will have to determine what the relationship between them is, because it's a very difficult question. And, you know, I put the burden on you. So, we are back to where we left off last time. The previous lecture, just one point, and I'll go over it briefly. So it's Plato, again, about 2,400 years ago, writing about the difference between kinds of knowledge. And we had a little debate last time about whether he's right or not. But he distinguishes between a kind of knowledge that starts with hypothesis, then tries to reach conclusions. And this kind of knowledge uses images. That's one sort of knowledge. And according to Plato, there is a more excellent kind of knowledge. Also starts with hypothesis, but then goes in a different direction to on hypothetical first principles, right? So that's where we find first principles, according to a philosopher. And according to Plato, no images are used, so no reference to this sort of thing. And the word that Plato uses is arche, right? So just throw out this word, Greek word, arche. He just mentions it one time. In this, all of this is from his famous dialogue, The Republic. So then Aristotle comes afterwards, and he now spends a lot of time thinking about this arche, the first principles, right? So he's trying to figure out what they are. And, Aristotle says, look, we can claim to know something only when we think that we know its primary factors. So it's arche, it's beginning. Because arche in Greek also means beginning, right? So we're looking for the beginning. We're trying to get to that source, the initial source of everything. So to give you an example, right, what would be such a primary factor? Okay, David, right? And so let's say we're trying to understand this sculpture, this particular sculpture. So one way to go about it would be to think about the material from which it's made. In this case, it's marble, right? So we can say, all right, we know what the material source from which the sculpture emerged. Another way to understand it is to think about what Aristotle calls the source of motion, right? So how did this piece of marble change into this particular statue? You had to have some kind of source of change. And in this case, it would be Michelangelo, right? So who is the source of this change from marble to David? Another way to think about it, and by the way, these are, some of you already recognize, I'm sure, these are commonly known as the four causes, right? But causes is a confusing word, so I'm not using it. Okay. So another way to think about the statue, trying to understand what this is in terms of an idea. And here Aristotle says the form, or the Greek word, another Greek word he uses is logos, and it's going to come up again. Okay, so the idea that forms the material, that's the language Aristotle uses, right? So this marble, piece of marble has a certain form. And when we understand this form, we understand the sculpture. And finally, the end. We're trying to understand the end. So what is the end of David, right? I'm speaking oddly, but trying to get this point of this fourth source, explanatory source. And maybe we can say, all right, we explain the statue by thinking about its effect on the audience, right? People come and look at it, and maybe, I don't know, they experience what? Pleasure, maybe they change in some ways, right? They get transformed by the statue, they just enjoy the statue, right? So that's another way to understand the statue itself. So we can understand it in four different ways, says Aristotle. And sometimes the ways coincide, but that gets more complicated. But anyway, I'm just trying to speak about the way in which Aristotle thinks about these first principles, the beginnings, right? So these four would be the beginnings of David. Okay, but now, the most exciting part. So Aristotle is concerned about the real first principle of everything, right? So what is the real first principle of everything? That's what we're trying to get at. And he says in Metaphysics, And that's by Aristotle, by the way. Isn't that a cool sculpture? It comes from Chartres Cathedral. He says, the surest principle, arche, right, this word, of all, is that about which it is impossible to be mistaken because it is the best known and not hypothetical. Right, again, the same idea as Plato, not hypothetical, and best known in the sense that this is something that we can know with absolute certainty. Right? Doesn't mean ordinary knowledge, but means the most certain kind of knowledge, best known. So here's the big secret of Aristotle, and it's going to be the principle of what I will say is logos-oriented society. It's a principle of non-contradiction. Okay? So this is the cornerstone of what we now have today as our culture, really, our sciences, our way of thinking, everything. Right? This is where it's formulated in Aristotle's Metaphysics. Okay, this is the principle. It is impossible for the same thing at the same time to belong and not to belong to the same thing and in the same respect. It sounds a bit confusing, but, you know, again, very simple. And this is an example that he gives later on. It cannot be at the same time true to say that the same thing is a human and not a human, right? There is this very simple principle. It has to be either a human or not a human. You cannot say both at the same time and in the same respect and so on, with all the qualifications. And again, this is, according to Aristotle, this is the most basic principle, the first principle, the arche, of everything. Okay, so here we go. Just to be very clear, either a cat or not a cat, okay? Cannot be both. And in fact, a cat and not a cat, these are known as contradictories. And there's also, so they're mutually inconsistent. And they exhaust everything. So, you know, you have a cat and not a cat, and these two categories, they include everything. They cover everything. So there's something also known as contraries, and those would be hot and cold. So they're contraries. They're inconsistent according to this principle. You cannot have something both hot and cold in the same respect at the same time and so on. So they're inconsistent, but they're not exhaustive, because you can have something in between. You can have warm, for instance. Right? So this is just this principle broken down. And Aristotle says this is by nature, and remember nature, here is physis, physics, right? So this is by nature the first principle of all other axioms. Everything. So let's think a little bit about this principle. And what I want to say is, first of all, Aristotle says, look, you cannot have a demonstration of it. And again, it's a logical point. You know, you cannot explain it, because to explain it, you would have to use something even more basic, right? But then you would get this infinite regress, infinity is bad, right? So it cannot be demonstrated. You cannot prove it, you cannot demand a proof of it, because it's the first principle. And in fact, he says, I'm not going to even try to do it. And, you know, if you want to challenge it, if you want to come up with your own first principle, go ahead, do it. Try to do it, he says. Try to do it, and in fact, I will show you that whatever you say is going to be wrong, right? Whatever you say is going to presuppose this first principle. That's his way of talking about it. And if, for instance, you decide not to speak, right, Aristotle says, then you're no better than a plant. That's what he says. So, in fact, what I'm also trying to say, Aristotle can be funny, believe it or not, right? And I think he knows, I mean, he does make this joke consciously, right? He says, you are no better than a plant if you remain silent, if you remain without words or without logos, without reason. So basically, if you will be unreasonable, and you will be a plant. You will not be a human being, right? Because remember this Greek definition of human being. Human being is a rational animal. And the Greek uses logos. It's an animal who has logos. So if you don't have logos, then you're a plant. Okay, so look, again, this is really the key point for us, for our civilization, which is a Western civilization, and we belong to it because we're here right now, right? We cannot not belong to it. In some way or another, we are entangled in it. And this is the most basic thing for Western civilization. From it, everything starts. All the sciences, all sorts of knowledge, every knowledge is based on it. And when you think about it, it's a very interesting story when you think about the stretch of time, starting with Aristotle, ending with us here. And this society of ours is focused on logos, on this principle, right? On the idea that you cannot assert two contradictory things or two contrary things about something. So in other words, our thinking is geared towards precision, making distinctions, right? It's either cat or not cat. We've made a distinction. It's either hot or cold, it's either day or night, it's either male or female, and so on. So in other words, what we get with this principle, we get a mindset that is focused on oppositions. It's focused on dichotomies. So we distinguish. We make things precise and clear. That's what we strive towards. This is a culture. And, you know, you might think, well, what's the alternative? Is there an alternative to deny this principle? No. You don't have to deny it, actually. And so I will just briefly talk about this alternative. Okay, here's the alternative. Heraclitus, you know, an ancient Greek before Aristotle, a little bit before, he says, the way, upward, downward, one and the same. Is that a contradiction? Some people thought so. Aristotle called this guy obscure. He said, the obscure. But we should not put Aristotle down that much. You know, he did have a sense of humor, as we saw. And also he had moments of lucidity. He, for instance, he did recognize, actually, Heraclitus is not contradicting himself. He did say it in the same chapter on metaphysics from which I quoted. He says, some people think Heraclitus actually, denies the principle of non-contradiction. But he doesn't, in fact. And this is exactly true. This saying does not deny the principle of non-contradiction. But instead, it's trying to do something else. And you know, if you think about this, what Heraclitus is actually saying is that upward, downward are opposition, is an opposition, right? The set of opposites. But the way upward and downward need not have an opposition. And we can take it a bit further and maybe you're familiar with the Russian philosopher, thinker, Mikhail Bakhtin. You know, he's taught grotesque realism, his terms, okay. But one of his ideas is that you need reversals in society. He says, once in a while, you need to have a situation like a feast, a carnival, where those who are on top and those who yield authority, who have authority, they go and become ones at the bottom, right? And again, he draws on examples from medieval culture. We can think about other non-Western civilizations, right, where there are rituals. in during which the rulers, the kings, are, you know, denigrated. You know, you throw mud at them, you beat them up, and you curse them, right? So what is this ritual trying to do? It reverses the up and the down. And perhaps this is something what Heraclitus is trying to say. Up and down are the same. So the hierarchies that we build in our societies are not real in the sense that we take them to be real. And that they need to be reversed, occasionally at least. So let me put it in a different way. So here we're talking about mythos. So if logos, right, this rational-based Western culture, is firmly founded on the principle of non-contradiction, then mythos is founded on ambiguity. And so an alternative to a logos-centered culture, our scientific culture, an alternative to it would be a mythos-oriented culture, where you have the basic principle of mythos-oriented culture, the archa of mythos, would be something like this. X and what appears to be not X. So again, it's not a contradiction. It doesn't violate the principle of contradiction, but it does look like it. So it looks like Heraclitus is violating the principle of contradiction. And let me give you an example. And another way to formulate it would be to say X is almost Y. Right? So this is the kind of logic. Not our logic. Not our usual logic. You're saying cat is almost not cat. Okay. So here's an example from the Greeks, Greek mythology. The scene here is the one during which Aphrodite, and she's on the right, your right. It's the Trojan War, right? It's from the Iliad, the passage. Aphrodite is trying to protect her son during a battle, right? And the other guy fighting her son is Diomedes, and behind him is Athena. Okay, so Aphrodite, the goddess of love, right, intervenes in this battle, trying to protect her son. And in fact, what happens is that Diomedes, because he knows Athena is backing him up, and he knows in front of him is Aphrodite, yet he, you know, throws a spear at the goddess, right? He has that sort of, he has the audacity to, yeah, to wound the goddess. And in fact, she's wounded. And she starts bleeding, believe it or not. Right? In the text, her blood is called a different name. It's a divine blood. But she's bleeding, and she's hurt. And in fact, she goes to Olympus, to her mom, Niobe, and starts crying, right? And says, you know, do something to these humans. They're getting out of line, right? And Niobe says, sorry, you know, I cannot do anything. Yes, sometimes gods have to suffer and they're heard by humans. I know. It's weird, but... And everybody around, all the other gods are laughing and making fun of her and saying, like, look, just, like, go do your stuff. You don't belong in battles. Go do your love-related stuff. Don't interfere in battles. It's like the real gods do the battles, like Athena and Ares. So... What is interesting about this passage is, again, the sort of logic that is behind it. For us, you know, for our culture, it's inconceivable. You know, a god is different from a human, right? Again, opposition, contraries. Divine, human. What the Greek mindset is different. Gods can bleed. Gods feel pain. Humans, on the other hand, can become divine-like. Maybe not gods, exactly, but they can become divine. Like heroes, right, for instance. Humans can become like gods. Gods, you know, so the line between divine and human is ambiguous. That's what I meant when I said mythos is based in ambiguity. It's not clear. The difference is still there. There is difference between gods and humans, sure. But then gods are made look like human and anthropomorphized, right? And humans become divine. So this is a different kind of logic. And it's still logic, right? It's still... it's still based on the principle of non-contradiction, but it's not taking it as the central focus of, you know, it's the mindset. So then the question is, you know, we've seen that the first principle of our culture is this principle of non-contradiction. And now we got a glimpse of a different first principle. What do we do now? As a society, maybe. And that's what I meant, that, you know, it's up to us to make conclusions about it. Some of you might be familiar with Heidegger, Martin Heidegger. I mentioned him earlier, right? He, for instance, thought that our society started from this Aristotelian principle of non-contradiction, ended up as a technological society, and basically very close to self-destruction, or something like that. It's doomed, right? Because, I mean, his idea was because we focus too much on rationality. So, did we place too many stakes on this principle? And should we shift some of the weight onto mythical logic? So that's one question. Another question, of course, is how does this all relate to what physics is doing, right? Do these principles make sense at all in physics and in the recent developments in physics? Can we find connections between what Vache was saying earlier and these principles? At least the principle of non-contradiction, maybe the four causes. So what's the difference between philosophical first principles and then the first principles of contemporary physics?
Okay, so it is 8 o'clock. Yes, so we will answer questions now, but in case you did need to go into the rain and back to your homes, we'll break for a minute or two, you can leave, but then I'll try to converse with Julie about this disturbing development.